So I've got with me here Chuwi's SurBook. This is their premium 2-in-1 tablet that is based around the Microsoft Surface Pro 4 screen. It's also the same screen that's used in the Microsoft Surface Pro, the 2017 model. So it's got a kickstand on it and an optional type cover that's backlit and an optional active stylus with 1024 levels of pressure sensitivity. So I'll be reviewing both of those items as well with this package. Now the 128 gigabyte model is the one I have here that is now finally shipping out for people that have backed the crowdfunding campaign. You should have a look at your emails and you should have a tracking number there for it. So other specs include 6 gigabytes of RAM, the Intel Celeron N3450. It's got Intel wireless AC, a 37 watt hour battery, 2 USB 3 ports on there, micro SD card reader, and then Type-C in for data and charging. So let's get this one here unboxed and check it out in greater detail. So here we have the active stylus. Now it's the Hypen H3, which is the exact same one that I think we had in the Chuwi HI13, their other tablet with an Apollo Lake N3450. So the keyboard here, I'll have a look at that first. Interesting to see what this looks like. To me, it looked like it was gonna be more like the Surface Pro 3 keyboard, the design of it. So they haven't spaced the keys out as much as the type cover you'll find on the Surface Pro 4. So it's very similar, you can see there, to the Surface Pro type cover, the third version, I think it is there. We do have a couple of status LEDs, and it's got that kind of like a fake suede-like material that hopefully is not going to get dirty after the process of time and use and things. It probably will, actually, and they normally do. And reasonably sized touchpad here, but I'll test that out later on once I get it connected up to the tablet. The rear of it, of course, has that material on it. Now, it's not a fabric. It's more, again, like a synthetic kind of suede-like material. So it secures in place with magnets, and we do have those two prongs there and then 5 pogo ports. Okay, so, they got a tempered glass screen protector on there, which is good. I think the crowdfunders, we all got that, so that's good that they've included that in the pack. So there's the tablet there, of course, but I'll first have a look at the power supply, which is in this little box on the side. All right, so you can see Type-C connection, and I do have an EU plug, not a US one, which is great. So this, of course, is rated to 12 volts, like all the other Apollo Lakes, and the output is 2 amps here. Nope, I almost forgot this. This was in the box here. So we've got some clean wipes. That's for the application of that tempered screen protector, and then your typical warranty card, a little instruction thingy, product report, and they even include an Intel Celeron sticker if you wanted to stick that onto the back of the SurBook. So just have a look at the weight of the tablet. grams there, and then if you add the type cover, comes up to 1.26 kilos. Okay, so place your bets. Is the screen going to be fully laminated? I couldn't find any information on this, and normally when they do not put it on the website, it's not fully laminated. And yeah, okay, it's not fully laminated. You can see there is a bit of a gap there, so that's slightly disappointing. I guess it was down to costs why they couldn't put a fully laminated panel on this. So the gap is around about 1 millimeter here. All right, so we have a look at the thickness. Comes in to be 9.3 millimeters, which isn't bad at all. I mean, that's slightly thicker than the Surface Pro. And then with the type cover, it's 13.8 millimeters. So the kickstand is held in place there with magnets, so when you move it around, it's not going to be flapping around everywhere. It's got a little bit of a resistance to it, but there's a couple of little cutouts there so we can lift it up. And you see under here we have a metal hinge, which is great, and there is our micro SD card slot. So on the right side we've got one of the two speaker grills, so it's got side-firing speakers. Here's the two USB 3 ports, the Type-C port of course, and then 3.5 millimeter headphone jack. And on the left side there is just a speaker grill. You'll see that also we do have a pre-applied screen protector, so you can either decide to leave that on there or go with the tempered glass screen protector. On the rear, we've got the same silver alloy that they've used for the kickstand, and you can see our buttons here at the top. They look like they're metal. They don't really rattle around or anything, which is good, but they could actually be plastic there. And here we have a 5-megapixel rear-facing camera. So the build quality overall is solid. It is screwed in place, the two halves with screws around on the rear side. The front around the screen is made out of plastic, and this hinge mechanism here, that's all metal. And it looks to me like it is well made, and hopefully it's going to stand the test of time there. But of course, we won't know after I've been using this for a few months whether or not this is going to loosen up. But it seems to be pretty good so far. So like other 2-in-1 devices, the keyboard clips in place. That type cover there. And then is held in by magnets. It doesn't seem like it's going to be going anywhere. And it also acts as a protector for the screen. So putting that up like that, you're not going to get your screen scratched at all. And it does sit up at this higher level here for increased typing comfort. Oh, it's actually turned itself on. So I must have pressed the button there. So the maximum reclined angle that the kickstand will go is right back here. So it won't lie completely flat or almost flat like the Surface Pro will, but it's not too bad. That should be a lot better for using the stylus there. And you can see an angle around there. Have a look at the hinge performance, that it's reasonably stiff, and actually tapping on that really hard, that is not going anywhere there. So seems quite solid so far. So there was an account already created on here. Now, if you're not happy with that, you can probably just go through the settings there and do a factory reset. But there doesn't seem to be anything installed here, which is fine there. Maybe it was just the factory when they do the test, they decided to set up an account. That often happens on a lot of this tech that I get. So first impressions of this touchpad here, it seems to be quite sensitive. I'm able to go in almost one motion from one side of the screen to the other, which is fine. And two gesture support at least, so there should be the Windows 10 gestures. Now I'll have to check out later on in my full review whether this is a precision mouse pad or not, but I got a feeling that it probably actually won't be. It seems all right so far at this point here. Now the keyboard, pressing down here, you can see there is a little bit of flex as expected for a thin type cover. Now key travel on these keys seems to be around approximately 1.2 something. I'll have to measure that, of course. But so far it seems all right. And we do have controls here for the brightness control of the screen, which is at 100% at the moment, currently overpowering my camera settings. And then I'll just turn that down to about 50%. And there doesn't seem to be any button there for print screen, which is a little disappointing. So a quick preview of the screen. So far, it seems really good, as you'd expect for a Surface Pro screen. So great colors and the brightness. I've got it toned down to 50% at the moment because it really does seem a little bit too powerful for my camera settings. Now you will notice that on the side here, you're probably seeing a little bit more reflection than you would, of course, on a fully laminated panel because of that gap we have and because I have the screen protector on here still. Now the accuracy of the screen to minimize things and bring this back up again, that doesn't seem to be too much of a problem or too difficult at all to do, even though this does have quite a high resolution screen. The GoodX touch panel on here, for the moment, at least in my early testing here, seems to be performing well. Now having a look at the components here, the disk drive on here is a SanDisk DF4128, and I've just finished benchmarking it. So you can see that yes, it is eMMC5 spec with that sequential 260 almost reads there. Little slower on the writes than I would have liked for a 128 gigabyte drive. Now you get free space approximately, what is it? 98 gigabytes. Yeah, well, 97.8 gigabytes free there. Now it does not have a SSD slot in here like the other Apollo Lake. So this is all the storage you're gonna get. Now, of course, if you've got the 64 gigabyte model, then you're only going to have around 48 or 50 gigabytes free there. So not really a lot to play with. Now, the Intel Wireless AC 3165, yet again, this is a decent chipset. It performs quite well. Of course, it's dual band on the 5 gigahertz band there. Nothing else really to note apart from here that we do have a Bosch accelerometer. And we do have an ambient light sensor, which I think is up this corner here where the status LED is. Now, the Windows build that it is using is the version 1703, so that is quite recent there, and no problems with the activation, of course. And you can see that they have used a tiny little bit of RAM dedicated to the internal Intel HD 500 graphics. Now, for a very quick preview of the stylus. So I do have a Microsoft stylus here that works on the Surface Pro, and this does not, of course, work on the screen. Nothing's detected, so don't even bother trying that at all. So the stylus can be clipped onto the side. There is a magnet just along this part along here, and it will hold on there reasonably strong there. I imagine if you pick up the tablet that you could actually have this end up dropping off. So there is pressure sensitivity and a hover function too that also works. It gives you around about 5 or 4 millimeters of hover. So it's registering that before it even touches the screen. So just going to have a couple of examples here. So drawing a straight line there. My hand's a little bit shaky. Overall, it seems pretty quick. There's a little bit of a delay there, as you can see. And the nib accuracy seems reasonably good. I'm in OneNote here at the moment, by the way. This is the built-in Microsoft application that you get. Now, pressing down harder will, of course, make that line thicker so I can see the pressure sensitivity. But I do have actually no way of testing those full 1024 levels of pressure sensitivity. That's pretty hard for me to test. But so far, at least in this application, I have no complaints. It works just like the Chuwi HI13 stylus. Well, a couple of complaints. That the nib doesn't have the rubber in it like you get on the quality styluses here. For example, with that Surface stylus, the nib of it has a little bit of rubber in the tip there. So it just feels a little bit better there. And because I've got the screen protector on there, no doubt that it will probably end up scratching that screen protector too when you press down really hard. Plastic against plastic normally results in scratches there. So in my full review, I will cover the stylus in a lot more detail and do some more tests and use it in applications like Photoshop. So it's now time to have a listen to those speakers. We've got dual speakers, one on either side, so one there, one on the other. So decent stereo separation. However, are they going to be sufficient and good enough? So let's have a listen here with my typical sample that I always test. So as you can hear from that, at 100% volume, there is some distortion, and they're not exactly the loudest sounding speakers. So a bit of a disappointment in the speaker department there. So I wanted to point out a few things here with the ports that we have on here. So we've got Type-C USB 3.1, so this is display, data, charging all at the same time. Now I have noticed that due to the way the port is, and really the way the housing is, so the housing has this bit of an angle to it, as you can see there, I found it quite difficult to really plug in my hub and even other devices I have. So you really have to kind of angle it down a bit and really push it in there. And the connection, because of that, it doesn't tend to clip right in. So a bit of a complaint there with this hub that I do feel that they should have maybe designed this a little bit better, that metal around the outside, or at least extend the port out a little bit more so it would clip in there nicely. So that's a minor complaint there. Now, the two USB 3 ports, they do power external hard drives, and so does the Type-C port here. So being a 3:2 aspect ratio tablet, it's quite comfortable to use in portrait here, and so far I've noticed that the touch seems to be good. A couple of times I have noticed that just like then when I touched the screen, it didn't register, so it seems to register only every 9 out of 10 times I've touched it. Now, it could be because of the screen protector or just maybe the fact that it needs the sensitivity tweaked on the touch. Now, sometimes you can go in via the registry editor and tweak that setting up there. But so far, I mean, the scrolling performance and that is to be expected for an Apollo Lake, and using Edge, it's quite smooth. Now, for Linux support, I just did a real quick test here, tried to boot my Manjaro USB pen drive that I have, you can see, plugged in, and it's come up with that typical error when it doesn't seem to work on some devices. It has that underscore, that cursor there that's just stuck at the top of the screen there. So at this point, I need to test this a lot more, of course, but it doesn't look like it's booting Linux, but I'll have to investigate that further later on, and perhaps in another video, I'll try and get Linux working. The BIOS here, as you can see, is pretty much locked down here. We've only got basic settings that we can adjust. So not like some of the other tech I've seen out of China that has the BIOS completely unlocked to the end user. Not the case here. And here's a quick peek at the backlit keyboard. So all the keys are individually lit here. It's well lit up. You can't control, unfortunately, the brightness of it. It's either just straight on or off via the function key here and delete. So that is the Chuwi SurBook, just my preview here, and first impressions are looking very good. So the build quality is great, the screen is premium, very nice. Now it's not on the same level as the Surface Pro for, of course, one main reason, and that's the fact that those screens are fully laminated, so the glass is optically bonded to the screen itself. Here it isn't, so they're separate, there's a gap of about 1 millimeter. And you notice that with a little more reflections, the blacks aren't quite as deep because of this, but it is a premium display, really, really nice, and probably the second or third best screen I have seen in a tablet. The best, of course, would be the Cube Thinker i35 that has the Surface Book screen in it that's fully laminated. Okay, so the keyboard itself, the material, that felt, that suede-like material, is very prone to dust and dirt, so it's going to be hard to keep this looking pristine and clean. But the key layout seems good, typing on it seems fine, the touchpad seems reasonably good, reasonably accurate. It's certainly not the best touchpad I've used with my first impressions here. Now the keyboard is very, very similar to the Microsoft Type Cover 3 that you had on the Surface Pro 3. Almost the same, the keys. It's almost as if it's made by the same manufacturer. So I discovered that the Type-C port has a slight little annoyance with it, that you really have to push the plugs in very hard when you're using your own Type-C hubs or a different charger and things like that to get the full proper contact there. So that's a slight annoyance, but it's good to see that the ports are working properly at least. We're getting display out, we're getting charger and data at the same time, which is good there. Now the webcams, I will test them out in my full review, but not expecting too much there. The speakers are slightly disappointing. They're not really that good, and most of the time, honestly, they aren't in these Chinese devices I review. So battery life, gaming, performance, benchmarks, perhaps Linux if I can get it to work properly, that will all be up and coming, and more Stylus tests in my full review. I do hope to catch you then. If you have any questions, let me know down in the comments as always. And I do hope to see you back in the channel soon. Bye for now.